Good morning.
Good morning.
You know, Jesus in his love warns us not to warn off the path, to stray off the path, right? And there are times where he has to point out the thorns. And so he's blessed us with prophecy. And prophecy helps us to stay on the path, right?
Amen.
And at times, prophecy even has to point out the thorns. And Revelation 17 points out some thorns. So before we begin, let us kneel in prayer where possible. Heavenly Father, we come before you, before your throne of grace, boldly, petitioning for your Spirit to be here with us. Father, we pray that as we go through your word, that we will have an understanding of your word and that which you are pointing out, the way of righteousness, and that we will see also the thorns. Not that we may focus on the thorns, but that we may focus on the way of righteousness. Father, I pray that you will touch my lips with a coal from off your altar, that I may present your words, your tone of voice, your body language, that your thoughts may come across clearly and strongly and in love. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It seems that one electronic device is not good enough for me. I have to now have two. I'm not fond of one to begin with, but so pray that I will remember. If I forget to flip a slide, let me know, because I might forget.
We might not know. You forgot.
You may not know, yeah. It's a good point. I want to start with a basic question. How many here can comfortably identify the woman of Revelation 17 that is the harlot there? How many, show of hands, how many can comfortably identify, at least in your own minds? I'm not talking about giving a Bible study. Okay? And that's kind of what I figured. Actually, I asked that question more to see if people were awake than anything. So, yeah, I've got an hour or less. I could, in that time, when I go through Revelation 17, if I go through the whole thing, I'm going to have to kind of skim on things. And the basics of that would mean another Revelation seminar. And I think most of us have probably sat through at least half a dozen. So probably within about 10 minutes, most people would be asleep. So what I want to do is I want to zero in. As I was looking at this and I was studying this, there were two points that really popped out to me that you don't hear in Revelation seminars. You don't hear being preached or focused in on. But as I'm looking at these things and as I'm searching them out through the Word of God to find out what God has to say about these things, they really start jumping at me. And they really, for me personally, began to clearly define and nail down the woman of Revelation 17 in a way that I have not seen ever preached before. And so that's what I want to do. I want to look at these two identifying marks. And so I'm not going to go through the whole chapter of Revelation 17. But if you want to open up your Bibles with me, we'll go to Revelation chapter 17. And I'll read probably about the first four verses. And I'll kind of give some commentary as I'm going along here. But then I'm going to start to zero in on two things that really seem to jump out at me. Revelation chapter 17 and verse 1, "And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me." I want to stop there for just a moment. One of the seven angels, which had the seven vials. This is referencing back or a thought process back to chapter 16. If you see in chapter 16, verse 19, it says, "And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath." So God makes mention of this And now in chapter 17, he's coming back to focus on this. And as he begins to focus on this, he's kind of laying out some waymarks, some identifying points before he tells us what the judgments are. So we continue reading, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither, I will shew unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Now judgment, I just want to touch on this for just a moment. When we look at judgment in the Bible, sometimes it can be confusing if we don't understand that judgment has three aspects. I think we've talked about that in previous camp meetings, but I just want to mention it again really quickly. Judgment can be investigation, it can be the verdict that's handed down, and it can also be the execution of that verdict. So when we see the word judgment, you've kind of got to ask yourself, which judgment is being spoken of? Does that make sense? Now, I'm not a Greek scholar, but looking at logos, it tells me that judgment here is the sentence. So God is telling us what the sentence is going to be for the female prostitute. And the female prostitute is someone who prostitutes themselves out for financial gain or for another gain. Does that make sense? And so I think we all understand that a woman in Bible prophecy represents what?
Church.
A church. So here is a church that is prostituting herself out for gain of some sort. And God is going to give a sentence or pass judgment upon her. And she sits upon many waters. Now verse 2, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. I want to stop there again for just a moment. The angel reveals that this is an immoral action. There's fornication. There's an immoral action, interaction that is going on between a church and state. Does that make sense?
Yes.
There needs to be, and there is to some degree, interaction between church and state. There is state here in this realm that we live in, right, on earth.
Yeah.
And there's also church here, right?
Yeah.
So there is to some degree some interaction, but it should not be immoral interaction. And we need to be sure that it's not an immoral interaction. Just like here, we're in the realm of Smyrna. We're all in this building. And even if we didn't speak to one another, when it comes time to leave, there has to be some sort of interaction for all of us to file through the door, right? But it's not an immoral interaction. And it's a moral interaction for us to interact with each other to get out the door. So with church and state, there is to some degree some interaction, but it needs to be a moral interaction. And what's going on here is not a moral interaction. And the result is, this from this immoral action, it has made people inebriated and drunk. To be made drunk, it is inebriated. Anybody ever given Bible studies to a drunk before? It's rather interesting. You usually get one of two things. You either get the individual who just wants to argue with everything when they're drunk, or you can tell them the grass is purple and they're going to go, uh-huh. And I've had both. And it's always interesting when you walk into a house and you've got a Bible study set up and here they are drunk. Uh-oh, which way is this going to go? But what's going on here is when you're inebriated, you have a hard time discerning between what is moral and what is immoral. And you tend to, in this case, take for gospel that which is not true. You just kind of go along and when the church says the grass is purple, okay, it's purple. And so there's a lot of revelation that is going on here just in these first two verses. And I think these are pretty powerful identifying points even of themselves. Verse 3 says, and he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. Now I'm going to come back to blasphemy. I think that is one of the two powerful identifying points that I want to delve into greater. So I'm going to come back to that one in a few minutes. Verse 4, and the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. Now that word decked there is to be golden. So she's golden with gold. The visual that pops to mind is, you know, in my past I've seen pictures of rappers. And they're golden with gold, right? They've got golden chain upon golden chain upon golden chain. There's gold in their ears, there's gold in their nose, and when they smile, there's gold in their teeth. There's gold everywhere, right? Golden with gold. And so this woman is, she's golden with gold and precious stones and pearls. In other words, she's decked out with all of these things. And having a cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Here is, I think, another powerful identifying mark of Babylon, full of abominations. Now, as I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, you know, what is an abomination? You know, I've read so many places, this is an abomination, that's an abomination, but I've never stopped to actually put it all together and to view what an abomination is from God's eyes. Now, I could tell you what an abomination is, but you don't want to hear my opinion, right? I hope not. I don't want to hear my opinion. I want to hear God's opinion, right? I want to know what He tells me is an abomination. And so, abomination, let's look kind of at a broad context to get a grasp of the word. We'll go through this fairly quickly. In Leviticus 18:22 and also in Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13, we find...
What's the second text again?
Sorry.
What is the second text
again? Chapter 20, verse 13.
2013.
Both found in Leviticus. And I've already forgotten to flip the slides. Thank you. So in Leviticus 18:22 and also in chapter 20, verse 13, we find that homosexuality is an abomination to God. Abomination is basically means something that is detestable. And so this is detestable in the eyes of God. We find also in Deuteronomy 22, verse 5. I'll get it. Deuteronomy 22, verse 5. We find, and these are my own words. These aren't the words that are found specifically in the Bible. I'm summing them up and putting them into my own words. But cross-dressing is an abomination to God.
That's right.
A man wanting to look like a woman or a woman wanting to look like a man. This is detestable in God's eyes.
Amen.
And how much of these things do we see today? This is why I don't want to just say and start talking about abomination, because abomination is defined differently by the world than it is by God.
Yes, yes.
And so this is why I want to go through some of these things to help us get a bigger grasp of what this word means and what it is to God. In Deuteronomy 24:4, we find that marrying a defiled woman is an abomination to God. And in Deuteronomy 24:4, what we find is a man who writes a bill of divorcement to his wife for whatever reason. She goes and marries another man, and then that man either dies or writes her bill of divorcement. And then the first husband saying, I want to take her back to wife. God says this is an abomination. It's detestable in His eyes. Here's another one. And again, these are my words. Playing favorites when delivering the justice God said should be delivered. This is an abomination. We find this in Deuteronomy 25, verses 13 to 16, and also Proverbs 11, 1. And I'll let you read Deuteronomy 25 on your own, but it's talking about when two men strive together and the wife of one of the men comes and stops the fight. Yeah. We'll leave it at that. It says that her hand is to be cut off. And when the husband does not do this, God says that's an abomination. You know, how many times have we seen in churches where God says that justice is to be dealt out to someone who's done something wrong in the church? And people will say, well, I don't really want to do that because they pay so much money into the church. And if I do that, they might leave and the money will leave with them. Or, and I want to make this clear, it's not necessarily the pastor's job to do the discipline. That's the church's job, not the pastor's job. It's the elder's job to lead that, not the pastor's job. But oftentimes it ends up as the pastor, and there's nothing wrong with that. But a lot of times what we see is the pastor, somebody over here that's not well-to-do or doesn't have a lot of influence will do something and discipline is quickly handed out. But someone who's influential, discipline is not handed out because maybe they're afraid of losing their job.
Just yes. For clarification, the reference for the woman intervened in the fight was in which verse, chapter and verse?
Deuteronomy 25, 13 to 16.
That's a different reference.
Yeah. Okay.
That's for divers' weights and balances.
Okay. I didn't get that one in there then.
Okay.
Sorry.
That is a reference.
Yes.
Does speak of it.
It does speak of it specifically.
Okay.
Just look up the word secrets and you'll find it.
Right.
And so there's a lot of these things going on. And you know what? God says that's an abomination. That's detestable in His sight. Doing these things is not fun. And if you think it's fun, there's a problem. It shouldn't be fun. But this is an abomination. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 32, and also in chapter 11, verse 20, God tells us that to be devious is an abomination. Are you beginning to see the broad context of this word? Abomination is not something that is very narrow that we have focused in on.
It's all abomination.
Yeah, bottom line, sin is an abomination to God. Sin is detestable in His eyes. That is really the bottom line of this.
Yep.
And of course, we can't skip over Proverbs 6, verses 6 to 19 when talking about abominations. Here God lists seven abominations. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto Him. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, an heart that devises wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he, not last but not least, he that soweth discord among the brethren.
That reference is 16 through 19, right? Not 6, 16 through 19.
It may be.
Just for clarification.
16.
For people writing. Chapter
16, it's 6 to 19.
Chapter 6, but verses 16.
16 to 19, yes.
16.
Sorry. Yeah, that should be 16 to 19, sorry. Chapter 6, verses 16 to 19. So we've seen kind of a broad overview of abominations. Does that help to kind of set a foundation is what I'm aiming for. Help to kind of set a foundation so that we're not looking quite so narrow. We need to broaden our view of what God says are abominations in His eyes or detestable in His eyes. You know, offering a blemished sacrifice according to Deuteronomy 17:1. That's an abomination to God. You know, when we come to God and Paul says that we should offer ourselves a living sacrifice, but if we're offering ourselves with all this known sin that we're clinging on to, is not that an abomination to God? That's an abomination to God. He wants us to let go of these things. I had more that I was going to talk about on that, but I'm going to keep going. And I want to touch on this one. The practices of other nations like diviners and charmers, God says is an abomination. Let's turn there. Deuteronomy 18, 9 to 14. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 9 to 14. And when thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. How do I apply that to today? I always ask myself, what does this mean to me, and what does this mean for today? As a religious body, we are not to learn from apostate Protestantism, right? Or Catholicism, or any other religion or denomination. We're not to take those practices and use them ourselves. What's that?
Or doctrines.
We're not to take them for ourselves, are we? Verse 10. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee. Thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. For these nations which thou shalt possess hearkened unto observers of times and unto diviners. But as for thee, the Lord thy God hath not suffered thee so to do. Now, as I was looking some of these things up, I see that these things, a lot of these things are overlapping in many regards. They overlap with each other. And so what I see is God is being, he's covering all his bases. Because someone could say, well, that's not quite what I do. This is really what I do. So it's really not an abomination. God is being clear, and he's nailing everything down so that there's no room for doubt. But as I looked this word up in Logos, it says divining. Speaking of divining, the pagan state or process of stating or determining the future through signs, omens, and supernatural powers. And then it says there's four broad classes of divination. One is using the position of the stars. Now I'm going to skip over two and come back to it. Three, examining animal parts or pot shards. And four, casting lots for a yes or no answer. Now, I've seen people today that profess to be Adventists do something similar to this. You ever heard of hanging a pendulum? They hang a pendulum real still, and they'll ask questions. And if it swings one way, it's a yes. If it swings another way, it's a no. And I've heard of Adventists that do that. But what I want to get back to is point number two, speaking with dead spirits. This is an identifying mark of Babylon, speaking with dead spirits. I can remember when I was a boy, I grew up just outside of Atlanta a little ways, southeast of Atlanta, and there was a place not too far from our home that had a big field. And once a year, people would gather from all over the United States and even from the world, and they would all come into this field and they would sit down and they would stare at the sky all day long. You know what they were looking for? Mary. She would regularly appear at that appointed time and that appointed place.
Would she appear or something like her?
Well, then that's what I'm getting to. In their minds, this is her appearing, but in reality, who is it that's appearing? It's the devil, right? Or the spirit of somebody that's dead. Is Mary in heaven? No, Mary's not in heaven. Mary cannot reveal herself. And I remember one time we drove by and my parents rolled down the window and as people were filing out and asked them, did you see anything? And someone said, oh yes, very clearly, she was right there. And I remember chills going up my spine. This was just down from our road, or from our house. But speaking with dead spirits. And in this system of worship, spirits appear on a regular basis. And they tell people this and they tell people that. Sometimes they tell them the future. This is, in a sense, divining. The other one, consulter with familiar spirits, someone who conjures and communicates with ghosts. Now, we oftentimes think of an occult or a seance going on. But that doesn't necessarily have to be what happens. So, you know, for me, I think this is pretty powerful identifying mark of Babylon and her doctrines. Speaking of spirits of dead people, which we know are really demons.
People in high places are going that much further. They're asking for help from demons.
Yes, people like in the White House
widespread
conjuring up. Yep.
Reagan's did it.
Yes, the Reagans. And I thought of
et cetera, et cetera.
Thought of that, and there's a lot going on. And this is the wine that has made people drunken. The church does it, must be okay. Another point in Deuteronomy 27:15. If you want, we can turn there. It's pretty close. Deuteronomy 27 and verse 15. Cursed is the man that maketh any graven or molten image, an abomination unto the Lord, the work of the hands or the craftsman, and putteth it in a secret place, and all the people shall answer and say, Amen. Amen. Is not that what this power does?
Yeah.
It has engraven images all over the place. In fact, it's attempted to change the Ten Commandments. And it believes that it has that authority to change those Ten Commandments. But friends, this is an abomination unto God. It's detestable in His eyes. That statue that they have, that they call Peter, is it not Jupiter? The toe is almost gone, as I understand. I've never been there. But the toe, I believe, is almost gone from people kissing it. This is an engraven image. And it's detestable in the eyes of God. That's hard to see. Sorry. I've put these two ideas together into one idea. So you'll see them, these ideas throughout. But I'll list them off for you so that you can see them. But it's the worship of false gods. And the other idea is attempting to worship the true God as the heathens do. Both of these ideas are an abomination to God. And you find it in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 25. For those of you that are taking notes, also in chapter 12, verses 29 to 32. All of chapter 13, which we're going to go to and read parts of here in just a minute. Chapter 17, verses 2 to 5. 1 Kings 11, 5 and 7. And also 2 Kings 23, 13. And there are other locations. I just stopped at that point. I didn't want to clutter the screen, but I see that's too late. But what I want to do, I want to just take just a moment and make mention. I don't want to dwell on this point too long, because I'm going to come back to the worship of false gods in Deuteronomy 13 here in just a moment. But to worship God as heathens do, I just want you to stop and think for just a moment. What does Easter have to do with the resurrection of Christ? This is the name, the modern name, if you will, of the goddess Ishtar. It's a heathen god, or goddess. And you know how you paint the eggs? It's interesting to go back and look at a study on all of this. And I realize there's always some debate on these details. But the painting of the eggs has to do with the eggs being dipped in the blood of child sacrifices. And so many Christians, we want to paint the eggs, but we don't realize what we're doing a lot of times. It's worshiping God the way the heathens did. You ever wonder why what Easter eggs, I always used to wonder this as a child, never made sense. What do Easter eggs and bunny rabbits have to do with the resurrection of Christ? Absolutely nothing. It's all about fertility and Ishtar. And as I understand, another name is Aphrodite in the New Testament. But I just want people to think about that, you know, and ponder that. Where do you draw the line? Where is it that you've crossed the line into worshiping God the way the heathens do? You ever notice that Easter also floats around? Did the resurrection of Christ float around?
No.
So just ponder those things. But let's go to Deuteronomy 13. Deuteronomy chapter 13. God says something, and He tells us the same thing from different perspectives or in different situations. And He tells it to us three times. Not once, not twice, but three times. Deuteronomy 13, starting in verses 1 to 4. If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and giveth thee a sign or a wonder, and the sign or the wonder come to pass whereof he spake unto thee. I want to stop there for just a moment. God tells us that we should know the prophets by if they give a sign and it happens. But here he's telling us to beware of something. And he goes on, that spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. What does he say? He says, thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Keep his commandments and obey his voice, and ye shall serve him and cleave unto him. So friends, even if a prophet comes and says, let's worship other gods, what should you say? Absolutely not. Let us worship a Trinity. What should you say? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. In no way, shape, or form. You know, it reminds me of Paul, when Paul says that though an angel were to come to you and preach another gospel, don't accept it. So you know what that means? Even if a prophet of God comes and tells you something contrary to the Word of God, which one should you go with? The Word of God. There is nothing more important than this, because the devil can perform miracles. So we cannot go by them. We have to go by the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Verses 6 to 9. For if thy brother, the son of thy mother, or the son of thy daughter, or the wife of thy bosom, or thy friend, which is in thine own soul, entice thee secretly, saying, let us go and serve other gods, which thou hast not known, thou nor thy fathers. The pioneers, maybe? Namely, of the gods of the people which are round about you, nigh unto thee or far off from thee, from the one end of the earth even unto the other end of the earth. Now, how do I apply that to today? Whether it be the religions that are close to us that, but are still apostate Protestantism, or the religion that is far from us, Catholicism. It doesn't matter. If they say to worship another god, God says, don't do it. Don't do it at all. What time do I have to?
Quarter after.
Okay. Verse 9. Well, verse 8. Thou shalt not consent unto him, nor hearken unto him, neither shalt thine eye pity him. Neither shalt thou spare, neither shalt thou conceal him. So, what this individual says is to be revealed for a disciplinary action. Verse 9. Now, verse 9 tells us how serious God is. But thou shalt surely kill him. Thine hand shall be first upon him to put him to death, and afterwards the hand of all the people. Now, I'm not advocating murdering somebody today, so don't misunderstand that. Execution. Thank you for that clarification. That's an important clarification. Yes. I'm not advocating executing somebody today, but there needs to be there's a spiritual battle that's going on. Yes. And so we need to look at it in a spiritual sense. Amen. Verses 13 to 18, we'll jump to this. This one, I hope, drives a little closer to home. Certain men, the children of Belial, are gone out from among you, and have withdrawn the inhabitants of their city, saying, let us go and serve other gods which ye have not known. I'll just stop there with that one. How would I apply that to today? Who is he speaking to? The remnant, right? Who is the remnant of God? Those that keep the commandments of God, right? All 10. Not just 9. Not throwing away the first, thou shalt have no other gods before me, but all 10. Here God is saying that there are some that have gone out from us that are worshiping false gods. And God is saying, do not follow after them. Do not follow them. don't go that way. In fact, he says to destroy the city, to burn everything, put everything to the sword. And God here is emphasizing his absolute abhorrence for this abomination. But herein lies, I think, a very powerful identifying mark of Babylon, worshiping false gods. This is a mark that is not delved into in Revelation seminars as a whole. Why? Because you don't want to point that out if you're worshiping the same God, do you? You can't point that out. You don't want to try to make that connection. So that connection is left alone, but it's something that we need to see, we need to understand. And we need to see this as an identifying mark, full of abominations. If we go back to Revelation 17, I want to sum this point up before we move on to point number two. What is going on? I clicked on the right side, but went the wrong way. Revelation 17, verse 4. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations, plural. Not just one, but it's plural. Abominations like diviners, or in this case, communication with the dead. Abominations like engraven images. Abominations like the worship of false gods and using heathen rites in their form of worship. These are identifying characteristics. The worship primarily, the one that really hits me is primarily the worship of false gods. And we're gonna, it's interesting how Revelation 18 comes after, which chapter?
17.
So we'll go into that in later detail. But the other one that we saw was blasphemy. Verse 3, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of the names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. Now, give me a definition of blasphemy.
To act like you can forgive sins.
Okay, to act like you can forgive sins. What about, I'm looking for the typical Adventist one. I'm looking for the specific one.
To call
thyself as God. To consistently reject truth and evidence, right?
Yeah, yeah.
This is the one that we always hear in seminars. You people are too well studied. You didn't give me the right answer. You're too well studied.
That is the one they use.
That is the one they use all the time. Is that correct? Yes, it is correct. But that's not the only thing that is blasphemy. That's not the only thing that's blasphemy. We find a basic definition in Revelation 13:6, and it's to speak against or to slander. This is really a broad definition of blasphemy, to speak against or to slander. And it doesn't just have to be against God or the Holy Spirit. In 1 Kings 21:10, it can be against the king. Blasphemy. Oftentimes, I've been charged with blasphemy. But we're going to look at this and see the broader context of blasphemy. And I think as we go through this, you're going to see this as an identifying mark of Babylon. One definition, if you will, and again, it fits under the broad definition of to speak against or to slander, but it's to claiming to be something you are not. Let's look at Mark 14. Now, I want you to realize that what is going on in Mark 14 is from a Jewish perspective, okay? That's something that needs to be remembered. So this, we're seeing a definition of blasphemy here, but we got to remember it's from the Jewish perspective. That's important. Mark 14, verses 61 to 63. This is Jesus standing before the high priest and the Sanhedrin. In verse 61, says, "But he," that's Jesus, "held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, Art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" Now, when you compare this, I believe it's with Matthew, the question is, "Art thou the Son of God?" So who's the Blessed? It's God. It's the Father. "Art thou the Son of God? Are you the Son of the Blessed One?" What does Jesus say? Verse 62, "And Jesus said, I am." He was claiming to be the Son of God. Yes. Right there before the whole Sanhedrin. He was claiming to be the Son of God. And he goes on, "And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven." Amen. Verse 63, "Then the high priest rent his clothes." By the way, I think it's in the Desire of Ages where Ellen White says that that is when they were divorced of God, when the high priest rent his clothes. That is when they were divorced of God. "The high priest rent his clothes and saith, What need we any further witness?" In their minds, and when you compare this with others, you find that this is blasphemy in their minds. Because in their minds, he's claiming to be something he's not. Mm-hmm. But is he the Son of God?
Yes.
Amen. Absolutely. And we find the same thing in Mark chapter 2 and verse 7, but we won't go there. And you find it in these other verses, Matthew 26, 65, John 10, 33, Mark 2, 7, and Revelation 2, 9. You find this idea of claiming to be something that you are not, as to be blasphemy. This Babylonian system claims Jesus to be the original God and not the Son of God. In a sense, this fits under the definition of blasphemy, claiming him to be something he's not. Is Jesus God?
Yes.
Yes. I've been hearing a lot lately that he's not.
Right. Maybe you should clarify, in what way are you saying he's God? Are you saying he's the sovereign universe?
And that's, thank you, that's what I was about to go into. I've been hearing a lot lately that he's not. But John 1:1, that's one of my favorite verses. That so destroys the Trinity doctrine, it's not funny.
Amen.
And yet they quote it. I love it. John 1:1. "He was with God, the Word was with God," and this is Jesus, "and he was God." How can he be the God that he's with? He cannot. That destroys the Trinity doctrine right there. But it clearly says that Jesus is God. Thomas fell at the feet of Jesus and said what? "My Lord and my God." Did Jesus say, "Oh no, don't do that"?
No.
No. Is he the Father?
No,
he's not the Father. But he is God. Even God said so in Hebrews 1. Titus 2:13 also, the great God. There's many places. But is he the original God? No. He's the express image of the original. He is 100% divine,
yes.
But he is the express image of the original. He's not the same thing.
Yes.
And to claim him to be something that he is not would fit under blasphemy. This organization claims to be a Christian organization when they're really a pagan organization.
That's right.
It's baptized paganism under the name of Christian.
That's right.
That's all it is.
Right.
They claim to be the representative of Jesus. They're claiming to be something they are not.
Yes.
In fact, they claim to be God on earth.
Mm-hmm.
That's blasphemy. And it fits under this definition. And that's a powerful identifying mark.
Yes.
Very powerful identifying mark. We'll look at one more. Attributing the power of God to someone other than God. Let's look at this. Matthew 12, 24. I'm going to be done a little bit early. And everybody says, oh, really? The long-winded preacher done early? Matthew chapter 12. And we're going to look at verse 24 and then 28 and then 31. Matthew 12, 24. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. Okay, so they're saying that the power with which he is using is not that of God, but it's that of the devil. So they're attributing the power of God to someone other than God, right? They're attributing it to the power of the devil. What does Jesus say in verse 28? But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. And when you compare that to Luke 11, 20, in Luke 11, 20, it says the finger of God instead of the Spirit of God. It's the finger of God. Now, it's not like God lopped off his finger and handed it to Jesus and said, throw this at them. It's a saying meaning the power of God. So he's doing these things by the power of God. And what do they say in verse 31? Wherefore I say unto you, this is what Jesus says, wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven unto men. This is the power of God that Jesus is using. But this system, the Babylonian system, says no. It is not the power of God. It's not the power of the Father. It's the power of another entity, another individual, God the Spirit. That, according to this definition, is blasphemy. You know, I've heard a lot of times, oh, you're in danger of blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Well, if you say that the power of God, instead of it being the Holy Spirit, it's God the Spirit, that's attributing the power of God to someone other than God. And by what I see, that is blasphemy. And I think these are powerful identifying marks of this system. So if we go back to Revelation chapter 17. See if I can do this. Nope. Went all the way to the beginning. Maybe I should have swiped. So when it says in Revelation 17 and verse 3, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy. Not one name of blasphemy, multiple names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. We find that blasphemy is to speak against or to slander God. And all of these other things of blasphemy do fit under this definition. When you claim to be something you are not, you're ultimately speaking against God. You're slandering God. And when you attribute the power of God to someone other than God, then you're blaspheming. And this it was kind of odd. It was getting a phone call, but I wasn't sure if it would show up. So, but this is an identifying mark of Babylon, to blaspheme. And it is something that for me, from now on, is going to go into my Bible when I study with someone. Because I think this really helps to nail down these points. And it also, at the same time, helps to show the importance of the truth that is found in the Word of God. That we are to worship the Father and the Son. The Father and Son alone are to be exalted.
Hallelujah.
Not someone else. No one else is to be put there. We are not to say that Jesus is something that he is not. We are not to attribute the power of the Father to someone else. And yet, this power does all of these things. And in Revelation 18, God calls us, come out of her, my people.
Right.
Come out of her, my people. Are you willing to come out of her? Are you God's people? Amen?
Amen.
Are you willing to come out of this system and its theologies?
Yes.
Amen. Where possible, let us kneel in prayer. Heavenly Father, we have gone through your word and we've seen just two very powerful identifying marks of Babylon. Father, I don't want anything to do with it.
Amen.
We, as a people, we want nothing to do with it.
Amen.
We could see in your word that these are abhorrences, these are an abomination unto you. And Father, we don't want an abomination. We don't want to be a part of that. And Father, we don't want to be a part of any system that is blaspheming you in any way, shape, or form.
Amen.
And so, Father, I pray that you will send angels that excel in strength to watch over and protect each and every one of us that has made a commitment here today before you to come out of these systems or this system. Lord, I pray that you will watch over and protect us because the devil does not want us coming out. He wants us to remain a part of Babylon so that we may receive of her plagues. But Father, we don't want to receive of them, and I know that you don't want us to. And so, Father, I thank you for each and every one here. I thank you for a family that has committed to follow you and your Son. And Lord, I pray that you will fill each and every one of us so fully with your Spirit that people no longer see us, but instead they see Jesus in us.
Amen.
And as we walk carefully picking flowers, thank you, Father, for pointing out the thorns. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.